It's been so long, oh, such a long time since I've lived with peace and rest. Now I am here, my destination, and I guess things work for the best. And I know
what seems to be a beautiful day outside. If you're a visitor, we're especially glad that you're here with us. Nearby in one of the seat pockets, you'll find one of these lovely green cards. At the midpoint of our service, there'll be an opportunity for you to give an offering. If you're a guest among us, then we are looking specifically just for contact information so that we can thank you properly for coming. You're welcome to contribute to our work here, the work of the Lord, but it's not expected of you as a guest. If you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you are welcome to celebrate communion with us also at the midpoint of the service. Now, there are a few announcements. Today is Daughter's Day, so happy Daughter's Day to my daughter, who's probably on her way here still, and the rest of you that are, in fact, daughters, happy Daughter's Day to you. We have small groups that are in the process of launching, or in fact, may have already all begun. Information on the groups is on the board out there, or you can ask anybody with a name tag. There are currently 6 small groups. That's in addition to the men's group that's alternating Friday mornings, and the women's group. The women's group is having its second of 4 of their fall meetings going through a book. That's going to be today. I believe that's at noon after church. So talk to Olivia or Nancy or one of the other ladies if you're interested in getting involved with the women's study. Other things going on in addition to those smaller groups, we have, in 3 weeks? Nope, today's the 25th, so 2 weeks, 2 weekends, 13 days, we'll have the fall bonfire out at the fire pit beyond, adjacent to the volleyball pavilion. There is a sign-up sheet out in the lobby so that we make sure we have the plenty of the things that we want to have at the fall bonfire. Hopefully the weather like this will hold, and it'll be very nice and pleasant. It's typically one of the best attended events of the year if the weather holds. Now, in terms of other announcements, it'll be another 51 weeks before we can celebrate Prairie View's birthday anniversary again, Lord willing. That was last week. By far, I sample all the desserts that I can because that's what I'm here for. And the Stark's dessert, the tres leches cake, was, I thought, the clear winner. But the cheekiest dessert was Jeanette, who took the 4th of July and served a British trifle. So aren't you clever? Now, we are continuing in our sermon series from the book of Daniel, and we are going to read several verses out of Psalm 25 this week, and I think we're going to do it next week, too, because there's a lot of stuff in Psalm 25 that matches up very nicely with the midsection of the book of Daniel. So we're going to read 1 through 7 of the 25th Psalm, which is from David. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Let me not be put to shame. Let not my enemies exult over me. Indeed, none who wait for you shall be put to shame. They shall be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all the day long. Remember your mercy, O Lord, and your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. Let's pray to this God and Father. Dear Lord, thank you for the chance that we have to gather in this space, read your word, seek you in prayer, and hear from you. And thank you that there are so many of us gathered in this space to sing your songs and sit under your word. And thank you for the work that Ben and Zach have done to prepare us this morning to enter into your presence. And Lord, thank you that you have made it possible for our transgressions to be covered and our sins to be forgiven, not by sweeping them under some sort of cosmic rug, but by taking them to the cross. Thank you that Jesus, your Son, was willing to go on our behalf, and thank that we can come to know him, not just information about him through your word, but come to know him personally through the Spirit. And thank you the fact that you've gathered us into churches so that we can encourage each other and support each other and give each other a prod as needed. And thank you for the chance we had last week to celebrate the 31 years of ministry that you've been doing through this community and 17 of them on this corner. And I pray that when another year has gone by, we'll have the chance to do it again. It's in your great name that we pray, Lord. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing.
Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is a God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice.
We are children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord, one with everlasting kindness, bought with sacrificial blood,
bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a Father who will never let them go. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King.
Sickness, all our sorrows, Jesus carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us, he is walking with us still.
Turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice! When you cry to him, he hears your voice. He will wipe away your tears. Rejoice in the midst of suffering. He will help you sing. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and raise your voice. Worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice.
my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will see your praise, oh Lord our God. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your
careful coming up the stairs, because 3 weeks ago when I was on the stage, I told Ben after church, I said, I've been on this stage hundreds of times, and that's the first time I almost fell down on those stairs. So had to be a little extra careful this morning. But hey, my name's Craig Hunter. I'm one of the elders here at Prairie View, and I'm going to talk a little bit about communion and offering before we go to the elements. But starting off with the offering, just excited to say that the year, believe it or not, in the business world, we say, hey, we're about ready to head into Q4, so the back quarter of the year, and the offering looks very good. If you ever look at the back of the bulletin, we're sneaking up on $250,000 collected so far. You extrapolate that out over the course of the year, probably going to collect between $330,000 and $340,000. And for a congregation this size, that is just absolutely amazing. So rather than stand up here and say, we need, we want, we have to have, I just want to say thank you. It's
We're able to meet all the needs. We're able to keep people employed full time. We're able to make the necessary improvements. We're able to have a thriving missions team and benevolence team and take great care of people who need it. So I just appreciate the faithfulness of the congregation and just ask that we continue to give sacrificially as we close out 2022. So going into our time of communion, I want to share just a little bit of a different perspective. For those of you who didn't notice, I wasn't here last week. Probably didn't notice. I sit way in the back, kind of mind my own business, keep to myself, real quiet. Not a couple laughs there, but not too many. But I was at a Lutheran church last week, going to church with my son and his family. And I've done that twice in the last 3 years. 3 years ago when I was there, I didn't get to see or be a part of a normal sermon. It was more part of a budget meeting or an update, if you will. So, but we got to church a few minutes early like we normally would, and we were wandering around the lobby, and it was good. It was a nice lobby. The music was playing, very similar to ours, a dynamic worship band just like we have here. So, so far, so good. I'm pretty comfortable and whatnot there. We did have to do a little bit of greeting. You know, I don't know, for those of you who've been here a long time, we used to do that here. We'd say, hey, take a few minutes and greet people. So, hey, I'm high-fiving the kids. I greet 10, 12 people. I'm doing okay with that. Things are going well. We move a little bit farther along into the sermon, and they have a kid's sermon, which I'm used to now, and that was pretty neat. They had probably 20 kids up front sitting on the ground, and everything went real well. We did the Lord's Prayer at least twice, and I'm good there. I knew that and was able to participate. Everything was going fine so far. They passed the offering, a little bit old school. We really haven't gone back from the pandemic switch, but they have. They're passing the offering plate, which was good. And then after that, it was getting close to time for communion. And my son, who many of you know, attended Prairie View for, 22 years or so. I can see him kind of whispering in the ear of my wife to kind of coach her on what communion is going to be like. And then she is telling Sydney and I what communion is going to be like. So we have to be ready for something different than we're used to. And boy, was it different. And I'm here to tell you why it was a little bit different. And I'm not here to throw stones at how other folks do communion, just to say that, hey, I feel real good about the way we practice communion and we give people the elements. So we get in a long line, and it probably took, 10 to 12 minutes. And then all I got to tell you is they're not real concerned about food safety, because I had to take the communion wafer out of somebody's hand, which kind of rubbed me the wrong way a little bit. Had to put one hand over top of the other one when I took my communion. And I'm pretty sure they used real wine. I'm not 100% sure. I'd have to ask somebody who's a little more familiar with it than me. But really, I guess the part that got me a little bit outside of my comfort zone is I had zero time to, as Paul says in Corinthians, to examine myself. I was literally standing up front, someone put it in my hand, and there was a young lady with a basket where I was to real quick eat the, and I mean real quick because there was a line of 50 people behind me, take the wafer, drink the wine, throw my stuff away, and move back to my seat. And in my mind, and as long as I've been sitting in those chairs taking communion, the few times I've been up here talking about communion, one of the key parts for me is that quiet time that we get to examine ourselves and to really think about why we're taking communion. And Paul's real clear in Corinthians, and this isn't an exact verse, but just a little bit of research. It says, in fact, communion reminds us of the forgiveness we experience through Christ. But Paul urges us to examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup, so that we are going to communion with a humble heart and not just pretending to be right with God. I had no time for that. Moving on a little bit, one of the Psalms, I think, says it very well. Psalm 32, 3 through 5. When I kept silent about my sin, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was drained away as with the fever heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and my iniquity I did not hide. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you will forgive my sin. I had no time for any of that. And I think that the message that I want to give to you folks today is that when you come up here, and I know it was Terry a few weeks ago that talked about routine, I'm glad we're in the routine of doing communion every week, but I also want you to really take the time to think and to pray about why it is we do that. And it's for the forgiveness of our sins. Jesus paid the ultimate price for us, and we owe that time to him to be in quiet prayer, meditation, and just thankfulness and gratefulness for what he did. And truly, when we take the elements, when we drink the juice, do we think of his spilled blood? When we eat the cracker, do we think of his broken body? We really urge you to take the time to do that when you take the elements. So I'm going to pray right now, and if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you are welcome to come forward and take communion and join us in this meal. Dear Father, we just we thank you. We thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on that cross for us. We thank you for his spilled blood. We thank you for his broken body. It is my prayer that the folks that choose to come forward today and take the elements do so with the heavy understanding of what exactly it is they're doing. And they take the time each and every week to examine their hearts, to confess their sins, and to be right with you. Father, we thank you for sending your son Jesus. And Father, we're just so grateful to be able to be here at Prairie View Christian Church every Sunday morning, taking communion with this group of believers. Father, we thank you. We love you. It's in your son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning again. Welcome to Prairie View Christian Church. Thanks for joining us here today. Well, last week, as we moved through Daniel chapter 2, we learned a lot about King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. And quite frankly, none of it was good. Nebuchadnezzar was a dreamer, but he couldn't seem to fully remember his disturbing dream. On top of that, he was demanding. He expected his wise men to tell him what the dream was and to discern its meaning. And Nebuchadnezzar could be cruel. When no wise man could do what he asked, he sentenced all of them to death. But that's when our old friend Daniel came through. Or perhaps more accurately, God came through. God gave Daniel the answers to Nebuchadnezzar's questions. Daniel spoke to the king, and lives were saved. Chapter 2 even ended with Nebuchadnezzar, of all people, worshiping the one true God. But, as we'll see today, that worship was short-lived. Our text this morning, Daniel chapter 3, contains one of the most famous, beloved, and dramatic stories of God's power to deliver his people in the entire Bible. But one of the most fascinating parts of Daniel 3 is what it doesn't contain. In chapter 3, Daniel, the man this entire book is named after, is nowhere to be found. Why is Daniel absent? The easiest explanation might be that he was off traveling on some royal business. But I also like to think that Daniel's absence here is yet another reminder that the book of Daniel isn't just about Daniel. The book of Daniel is about God. And this morning, God is once again going to deliver his people from certain death. But Daniel 3 also raises a challenging question for us to consider. What if he doesn't? So open your Bibles to Daniel chapter 3, verse 1. Feel free to use one of our Bibles if you didn't bring one, and take a Bible home if you don't have one. But before we read, let's pray. Father, thank you again for this day. Thank you for this time that we have together as brothers and sisters in Christ, as people made in your image with dignity and worth and value. And thank you that though we are sinners, every one of us, you are at work restoring your image within us. You are at work helping us learn to be the people you made us to be, learning to be your children, learning to be your servants. And that all comes back to the cross. That all comes back to Christ, our moment of redemption. So, Lord, thank you for our redemption through Christ's body, through Christ's blood. And thank you that you are changing us and shaping us and forming us to be the people you say we are and to be the people you call us to be by faith in Christ, by the power of your Spirit. And, Lord, thank you that you've given us so much in this life. You've given us everything eternally. But you owe us nothing. You are generous, you are gracious, you are kind, and it is a privilege to worship you this morning. And I pray that our worship would be honoring to you, that it would be beneficial for us as we come here with pains and weaknesses and failures. Maybe we come with joys and successes and triumphs from the past week. But Lord, whether we need to be comforted or humbled, I pray that you would do what you need to do for us through your word, through the music that we sing, through the prayers that we pray. I pray that you would shepherd us today and that our worship worship would be honoring to you today. Again, we love you. We love you. We glorify you. We praise you. We thank you. We ask this all in Christ's name. Amen. Well, starting in Daniel chapter 3, verse 1. King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold whose height was 60 cubits and its breadth 6 cubits. This thing was very tall and very narrow, about 90 feet tall, 9 feet wide. He set it up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then King Nebuchadnezzar sent to gather the satraps, the prefects, and the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the justices, the magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then the satraps, the prefects, and the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the justices, the magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces gathered for the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. And they stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. And the herald proclaimed aloud, "You are commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages, that when you hear the sound of the horn, pipe, lyre, trigon, harp, bagpipe, and every kind of music, you are to fall down and worship the image that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall immediately be cast into a burning fiery furnace." Therefore, as soon as all the peoples heard the sound of the horn, pipe, lyre, trigon, harp, bagpipe, and every kind of music, all the peoples, nations, and languages fell down and worshiped the golden image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. We wondered last week if Nebuchadnezzar would really learn anything from his frightening dream. And sadly, it appears the answer is no. His dream was of a massive statue made of gold, silver, bronze, and iron mixed with clay, four sections representing four kingdoms, but ultimately struck down by God's kingdom. And in that dream, Babylon, of course, was the head of gold. Now, Nebuchadnezzar should have learned that worldly kingdoms come and go, including his. But rather than being humbled, it appears Nebuchadnezzar was emboldened. Instead of reflecting on his own frailty, he may have started thinking of ways to prolong his reign and to shore up his power. In his dream, the statue was split into four sections, four different materials, representing four kingdoms. But this statue is all gold, from top to bottom. In Nebuchadnezzar's mind, there's only room for one kingdom, and it's his. Now, as we read those verses, you may have wondered, what's the point of those lists? The list of instruments may strike us as a bit odd. It's repeated so many times. But look at it this way. The repetition really stresses that any time anyone hears any kind of music in Babylon, they are expected to hit their knees in worship. And the other seemingly unnecessary list, satraps, prefects, governors, counselors, treasurers, justices, magistrates, officials, peoples, nations, and languages, it too is obnoxiously redundant in these verses. Maybe that's stressing to us that all people of Babylonian society, from the wise men to the dog catcher, are expected to worship Nebuchadnezzar's idol. I suspect the other reason for these lists is that the repetition ratchets up the peer pressure. It's a long-winded way of sending a very simple message, one that we hear today as well. Everybody's doing it, and they're doing it all the time. At least almost everyone. Verse 8. Therefore, at that time, certain Chaldeans came forward and maliciously accused the Jews. They declared to King Nebuchadnezzar, "O king, live forever. You, O king, have made a decree that every man who hears the sound of the horn, pipe, lyre, trigon, harp, bagpipe, and every kind of music shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast into a burning fiery furnace." There are certain Jews whom you have appointed over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, pay no attention to you. They do not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. So Daniel's three friends refuse to participate. As we said, turning the focus away from Daniel and toward these three men may be another subtle reminder that this book isn't just about Daniel. He's not the true hero of the story. He's not even the only faithful Jew. These three men also know that there's only one God worthy of worship. They also know that this one true God has commanded that his people have no other God before him, and that they must never bow down or serve a false image. And that's when some of their Babylonian peers, perhaps out of jealousy, expose their lack of compliance to Nebuchadnezzar. So what will the king do? Verse 13. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in furious rage, commanded that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be brought. So they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar answered and said to them, "Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the golden image that I have set up? Now, if you are ready when you hear the sound of the horn, pipe, lyre, trigon, harp, bagpipe, and every kind of music, to fall down and worship the image that I have made, well and good. But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be cast into a burning, fiery furnace. And who is the God who will deliver you out of my hands?" Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up." Religious freedom exemptions did not exist in Babylon. So when the three men are called to account, Nebuchadnezzar essentially asks three simple questions. Is it true? Are the accusations against these men legitimate? Will you recant? If given another chance, will Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego get with the program? And finally, is it worth it? Nebuchadnezzar has a fiery furnace with their name on it if they are unwilling to cooperate. These three men have already had their feet held to the fire metaphorically in the book of Daniel. But now it's literal. Will they remain faithful at the cost of their lives? The three men give Nebuchadnezzar three answers. Yes, it's true. There may even be a hint of sarcasm or defiance in their response. No, we won't recant. They fear the king of heaven more than the king of Babylon. And by their refusal to recant, they answer the third question. Apparently, they do think that faithfulness to God is worth a fiery death. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego clearly state in verse 17 that God can deliver them from their fate. But notice what they say in verse 18. Even if God doesn't, it won't change a thing. These men would rather die in faith than live in sin. Now, they have plenty of reason for confidence in God's ability to deliver them. He did it back in chapter 1 when they stuck their necks out there and refused to eat the king's food. He delivered them in chapter 2 when they were moments away from being torn limb from limb. So far, God has provided their needs, answered their prayers, and saved them from harm. When it comes to delivering his people, God is batting 1,000 in the book of Daniel. But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego bring up that challenging question we asked earlier. What if this time he doesn't? Now, it's important to emphasize that these three men bringing up the possibility that this time around God might not save them, that is not evidence of a lack of faith. Again, they know God's power better than most. They display incredible courage that they couldn't possibly muster up apart from a deep and abiding faith. And as we saw, they have no problem looking Nebuchadnezzar in the eye and insisting that God is far stronger than he is. They don't lack faith. But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego have the wisdom. They have the humility. They have the honesty to say out loud that God might not deliver them. And what if he doesn't? For them, that possibility doesn't change anything. But be honest, does that possibility change anything for us? Picking up in verse 19. Then Nebuchadnezzar was filled with fury, and the expression of his face was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times more than it was usually heated. And he ordered some of the mighty men of his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and to cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their cloaks, their tunics, their hats, and their other garments, and they were thrown into the burning fiery furnace. Because the king's order was urgent and the furnace overheated, the flame of the fire killed those men who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell bound into the burning fiery furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished and rose up in haste. He declared to his counselors, "Did we not cast 3 men bound into the fire?" They answered and said to the king, "True, O king." He answered and said, "But I see 4 men unbound, walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt. And the appearance of the 4th is like a son of the gods." Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the door of the burning fiery furnace. He declared, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out and come here." Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out from the fire. And the satraps, the prefects, the governors, and the king's counselors gathered together and saw that the fire had not had any power over the bodies of those men. The hair of their heads was not singed. Their cloaks were not harmed, and no smell of fire had come upon them. Nebuchadnezzar answered and said, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him, and set aside the king's command, and yielded up their bodies rather than serve and worship any god except their own god. Therefore, I make a decree. Any people, nation, or language that speaks anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be torn limb from limb and their houses laid in ruins. For there is no other God who is able to rescue in this way." Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. We saw Nebuchadnezzar's cruelty in chapter 2, and we see it again in chapter 3. He shows total disregard for human life. Nebuchadnezzar's own soldiers are killed just so he can prove a point. But you know who doesn't die? Those three faithful men. In fact, they're miraculously joined by a fourth. Now, there's long been fascination over the identity of that fourth man. Is he an angel? Is it a vision of the pre-incarnate Jesus? We don't know for sure. But we know that God delivers Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And once again, the thin-skinned, thick-headed, and hard-hearted king learns a valuable lesson. But we've seen this story before, haven't we? Sure, Nebuchadnezzar exhibits some form of conviction, repentance, faith, and worship. He even honors the three men who openly defied him, which can't be easy for a king to do. But we also saw how short-lived this conversion was at the end of chapter 2. Will this one be any different? So in the end, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego once again experienced God's deliverance, like they had several times before. But what if they hadn't? What if the furnace really had done them in? What if that mysterious fourth man hadn't appeared? What if the story had ended with these three men reduced to ashes, rather than exalted to positions of power? That's how the story has ended for a lot of persecuted Christians throughout history. For these three men, that different ending wouldn't have changed a thing. Because these three men do not worship God for what he can do for them. They do not worship God for what he might do for them. They worship God for who he is. Is the same true for us? I'm really not sure I can overstate how much that question matters. Too often we have an assumed, unstated, unbiblical theology that treats our faith and treats God himself as a means to an end. We view faith as a kind of currency that we exchange for worldly rewards, help, or avoidance of suffering. If I just give God the right amount of currency, faith, he is then obligated to bless me. It may be as grand as expecting God to always give us physical health, financial prosperity, and earthly success. Or it may be as small as expecting God to give us a prime parking spot on a rainy day. The mentality boils down to this. If I just believe strongly enough, pray frequently enough, or declare, name, and claim goals, desires, and blessings confidently enough, then I can twist God's arm into giving me what I want. A theology like that, the kind openly preached and practiced by some churches and Christians, but that can also sneak into churches like ours and Christians like us, that kind of theology is a shallow, dangerous, heaping pile of garbage fit for Nebuchadnezzar's furnace. God is not a vending machine. He's not a transaction partner. He's not an errand boy. God is not a means to an end. He is the end. And whether God does what we ask him to do or not, whether he spares us from every persecution, illness, disaster, job loss, divorce, or any other worldly hardship we can think up, he still deserves our worship. He still deserves our obedience. He still deserves our faithfulness. Those things are not contingent upon God doing everything we ask him to do. We worship him for who he is, and he never changes. That is more than enough reason to love him. Of course, this is hard for us to grasp in a day and age characterized by emotivism, therapeutism, and instant gratification. We often expect to be spared from every unpleasant feeling, every unexplainable suffering, and every inconvenience of waiting. And God surely does, and surely can spare us from those things, and he probably does it more than we will ever realize. But he is not obligated to do so. Our faith does not ensure us that he will do so. The Bible makes that much clear. Job suffered more devastation in a day than many of us will experience in a lifetime. It certainly was not for a lack of faith. And somehow Job can say, though he slay me, I will hope in him. The psalmist understood that faith is no guarantee that we will be delivered from every danger or threat. And even though God may test us and try us, we still have reason to sing the glory of his name. The apostle Paul understood this as well. Though Paul endured immense hardship and begged God to take away the afflictions that he faced, he also knew that God's grace was sufficient for him. All of these saints suffered faithfully. They worshiped God for who he is, not just for what he can do. That's important for us to remember because there may come a moment when we find ourselves in Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's shoes. We will be expected to worship idols, bow down before rulers, and participate or celebrate in sin. Everybody's doing it all the time. We'll be tempted to compromise. We may even find ways of arguing that what is clearly a compromise isn't actually a compromise. Well, God wants me to provide for my family, and I can't do that if I lose my job, so I should probably just go along with the sin. Yeah, I bow down to the idol externally, but I didn't really mean it internally. You know, I'll just compromise now and ask for forgiveness later. I don't want to harm my credibility with sinners, so I'll just give a little bit of ground here. It's strategic. We are gifted practitioners of justifying and rationalizing cowardice. We will face these challenges. We will have to choose. And there is no guarantee that God will spare us from negative consequences of that choice. But our faith, our obedience, and our worship are not contingent upon that anyway. We worship God for who he is. If he delivers us, great. We worship. And if he doesn't, we'll worship him then too. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2, starting in verse 18. Peter writes, "Servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. For this is a gracious thing, when mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it if when you sin and are beaten for it, you endure? But when you do good and suffer for it, you endure. This is a gracious thing in the sight of God. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. And in chapter 4, verse 12, Peter continues. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. The Apostle Peter had no qualms about calling Christians to faithfully suffer injustice, because our Lord faithfully suffered injustice. But Jesus knew that the Father's refusal to take the cup of the cross away from him did not negate his goodness, his sovereignty, and his love. The Son's obedience to the Father was not contingent upon deliverance from worldly suffering. And in the end, Jesus' faith was vindicated in his resurrection. And because Jesus was not delivered from his suffering, at least not right away, we can endure our own seasons of suffering. We can look ahead with confidence, knowing that while God may not deliver us from the furnace's flames, he will surely deliver us from hell's. And that is more than enough reason to thank him, more than enough reason to praise him and obey him now, no matter how much heat we face down the road. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this time that you've given to us. Thank you for this time in your word. And thank you for this incredible story that we've probably heard before, that we've maybe seen depicted in Sunday school lessons and cartoons and flannel graphs. And it never gets old. It's an amazing story of your deliverance, and it ranks right up there with the dramatic stories of the Exodus or the sun standing still. But at the same time, Lord, this story teaches us more than just your power to deliver. It challenges us to be faithful if and when you don't deliver us. We've all been there when we want something to be different. We pray for help, we pray for healing, we pray for answers, and the help or the healing or the answers don't come the way we wanted them to come. Lord, I pray that in those moments, when you don't do what we ask you to do, that we would still trust that you are good, still trust that you are sovereign, still trust that you love us, and still give you the worship and the praise that you deserve. Thank you that you will deliver us, that you have delivered us from sin and death and hell, that though we die, we will live. Thank you that sin no longer has the hold on us that it once did, that we don't have to fear hell's flames because we know who you are and we know what you've done. And that doesn't change no matter how many hardships or trials or sufferings we face in this life. Help us look forward to that deliverance, to give us hope and endurance and peace and joy, even as we're not delivered from every hard thing for now. Lord, thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for his death, his resurrection. And Lord, I pray that you would find us faithful when you come in power and glory. We love you, we praise you, we thank you. We ask this all in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing.
darkness tries to roll over my bones, and sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know, oh, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Has a place to hide, and I am not a captive to lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. There's power that can break off every chain.
Heard a story of a theologian who would walk around on a seminary campus, and he had been racked with health issues, and his body was deteriorating and breaking down, and much of the time he felt pretty miserable. And prayers for his healing and prayers for his recovery and prayers for cures had not been answered. And he would walk around campus, and whenever somebody would ask him how he was doing today, his response would be, "It's nothing a good resurrection can't fix." He recognized that he might not be delivered from every ailment, every harm, every danger, every threat in this life, but he kept his eyes fixed on the deliverance that was sure, that was guaranteed, that was set in stone. We asked that question earlier today of what if God hadn't delivered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? And again, there are countless Christians throughout history who have been burned at stakes, and they didn't get delivered. There was no fourth man there to save them from the flames. But there's one deliverance that we don't have to ask that question about. What if God doesn't come through? What if God doesn't save me this time? What if God doesn't deliver me? And that's our eternal deliverance that is set and secured and sealed by Christ, and nothing can change that. So if you have any questions about what it means to be a follower of Christ, what it means to go through the ups and the downs and the trials and the challenges of life in a fallen world where we don't always get saved from the bad stuff, but we can get saved from the eternal bad stuff, if you have questions about that, please talk to an elder, a pastor, a brother or sister in Christ here in this room. We would love to have that conversation with you. And if you're new and we just want to get to know you better, we'd love to have that conversation too. If there's some way we can pray for you, we would certainly like to do that as well. And as we said earlier in the service, I think, the women's study meets today. So if you need to run home and grab lunch or run out and get something, feel free to do that and then come back around noon is when they'll begin. And we certainly hope that we will see you next week as we continue in the book of Daniel. But with that, I will close us in prayer. Father, again, thank you for this day. Thank you for your kindness and your grace and your mercy and your goodness that never change. You are who you are, regardless of what we're going through. Whether we're on top of the world, the way Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego sometimes were, or whether we're being thrown in furnaces, you are still you, and you are still worthy of our worship and still worthy of our obedience. And I pray that our faithfulness to you would not be dependent upon you answering every prayer the way we want you to answer it, or you giving us everything that we think we want or that we think we need. Rather, I pray that our worship would be based in your attributes and your character that are time-tested, that are proven. You have shown for so long in so many ways to so many saints how faithful and good you are. And I pray that you would help us remember that even when times are hard. Help us be willing to stare down danger, be willing to stare down opposition, be willing to stare down threats, and be faithful to you, even if it costs us something. I pray that you would give us that courage, give us that faith, give us that endurance that only you can give by your grace and by the power of your Spirit. And Lord, thank you again that our eternal deliverance is sealed. And we don't have to ask that what-if question about our eternal fate. Thank you that Christ died and rose and ascended and one day will come again, and that we will have deliverance. We will have resurrection. We will have salvation when that day comes. Again, we love you. We thank you. We praise you. We ask this all in Christ's name. Amen.
The king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he's my song. And let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he's my song. Yes, you are God. Good. Oh, you are good. You're good.